Hello and welcome to session 7 of UGBS 204 Macroeconomics and Business. In this section, we are mostly going to talk about monetary policy. In the last session, we introduced the concept of money and looked at the demand and supply of money. So in this session, we are going to extend that discussion and then try and understand monetary policy. So the session we usually talk about monetary policy and the tools available to central banks for the conduct of monetary policy. And then also we are going to learn how we use the money market to study the effect of monetary policy. So at the end of this session, it's expected that students will be able to explain the concept of monetary policy and the type of monetary policy, and also be able to identify and explain the various tools available to central banks to conduct monetary policy, and also be able to explain how monetary policy can be used to control the price level. So the key topics are the meaning of monetary policy, the tools for the conduct of monetary policy, and the money market equilibrium. There are two main readings required for this section, pages 338 to 345 of the Mankiw and Taylor textbook, and then also the most recent release from the Monetary Policy Committee of the Bank of Ghana, and then the most recent the releases are available in the link provided in your slides. So it's important that you get this. At some point, we are going to refer to the Monetary Policy Committee release from this link. So let's start by trying to understand the meaning of monetary policy. What is monetary policy? Well, monetary policy generally refers to changes in the money supply that the central bank or the monetary authority use to influence the level of economic activity and to stabilize prices. In general, monetary policy is conducted by central banks, even though it's common to hear that the government is conducting monetary policy. But the specialized institution of government that conducts monetary policy is called the central bank. In the case of Ghana, the monetary policy is conducted by what we call the Monetary Policy Committee of the Bank of Ghana. So it's a special committee created by the Banking Act that is mainly responsible for determining the direction of monetary policy in this country. Now, monetary policy, just like fiscal policy, may either be expansionary or contractionary. The monetary policy is expansionary, or it is loose, when the central bank tries to increase the money supply. So when money supply is increased, we say that there's expansionary monetary policy. On the other hand, if the money supply is reduced, we say that there's a monetary tightening or contractionary monetary policy. So to appreciate understanding of monetary policy, we need to understand how money supply is controlled. Now, in session 6, we learned that the central bank is responsible for printing money. Well, yes, it's responsible for printing money, but the central bank in general controls the level of money supply. How does the central bank control the level of money supply? Well, first, we are going to study the specific tools available to the central bank for controlling the money supply. But you also have to understand that the commercial banks also have a role in affecting the level of money supply. They don't print. We learned in session 6 that central banks print the money and they can control it. Commercial banks can also influence the level of money supply through their deposit creation role. Now, how does the central bank control the money supply? Well, there are a whole series of measures available to central banks to control the money supply. The major conventional ones are what we call the open market operations, the reserve requirement policy and then the discount rate policy. Now, in recent times, since the last global financial crisis, a previously unknown tool called quantitative easing has also become popular. But we are not going to be talking about that in this session. So what is open market operation? Well, open market operation refers to the purchase or sale of government securities on the open market by the central bank. So the open market here refers to people, institutions and individuals who are licensed to deal in government bonds and other securities. And then the government securities we are talking about here refer to government treasury bills, government bonds, government one-year notes, and so on and so forth. So in Ghana, we have the 90-day, the 91-day treasury bill, the 180-day, we have the one-year note, we have the three-year note, and two-year bonds, and so on and so forth. All of them constitute government securities. Now, how do the central bank use open market operation to affect money supply? So consider the case of an open market sale of 100 million CDs. This means that those of you who have purchased treasury bills before, it means that the central bank is going to issue you a piece of paper, which is a promissory note that will tell you that at a particular point in time, you are going to be paid some amount, and so on and so forth. Now, they are going to issue you that piece of paper, and they are going to collect your money. So you are going to pay for the treasury bill. Now, how do you pay for the treasury bill? You are either going to take cash or you are going to write a check to be drawn on your account. Now, when you pay with that cash or check, it means that that money is going to go to the central bank. Remember that cash of the central bank is not part of the money supply. So it means that when you pay for the treasury bill, it is reducing the amount of money in circulation. So in other words, when there's an open market sale, it's going to reduce the amount of money supply. On the other hand, if the central bank purchases the treasury bills from you, it means that it's going to take that piece of paper from you and in return it's going to pay you. Now the amount of money it pays you is going to increase the money supply, that's the money in the system. So when there's an open market purchase, it's going to increase the money supply, and there's an open market sale, it's going to reduce the money supply. So whenever the central bank desires to reduce the money supply, it simply has to conduct an open market sale, and whenever it wants to increase the money supply, it is going to conduct an open market purchase. So that's how open market operations are used. It's by far the most popular and most common tool available to central banks for conducting monetary policy. Now, the reserve requirement. We already explained in session 4 that there's a required reserve ratio. That is a fraction of all deposits of commercial banks that are required by law to keep with the central bank as reserve. Now, remember that whatever they keep as reserves, they will not be able to make loans out of them. So whenever this reserve is increased, it means that their ability to make loans is reduced. Therefore, if the central bank wants the commercial banks to make less loans, that is to reduce the amount of money supply, it will simply increase the required reserve ratio. And that will easily limit the ability of the commercial banks to make loans. Note that if the commercial banks are already keeping excess reserves, then this policy may not be very effective. And then finally, we also speak about the discount rate. The discount rate is the rate at which the central bank lends money to the commercial banks. Now, take a simple example where the commercial bank has to go and borrow from the central bank in order to come and lend to you. If that's the case and the discount rate goes up, it means that it will cost the commercial bank more to borrow from the central bank, and therefore it has to lend it on to you at a higher rate. So when this cost of borrowing goes up, it's going to reduce the amount of new borrowings, and therefore that will reduce the money supply. Okay, so having studied how the central banks control money supply, we are now going to look at how. So we've already studied the demand for money, and we've also studied the supply of money. And now we've looked at how the central bank can control the supply of money. Our next task is to see how monetary policy works through the money market. As we know in economics, whenever we talk about a market, we talk about the demand side and the supply side. So when you talk about the money market, there's going to be the demand for money and the supply of money. In the first, in session 6, we spoke about the demand for money as the demand for real balances, either to make transactions or to take advantage of interest rate opportunities. That's the demand for money. Now, we explained that the demand for money is a decreasing function of the real interest rate. That is, the higher the real interest rate, the lower the demand for money. And the reason is that when the interest rate is high, it means that the opportunity cost of holding money is high. When interest rate on other assets is high, when you hold more money, you are giving up the opportunity to earn the higher interest. Therefore, the higher the interest rate, the lower the demand for money. In other words, when we draw a demand for money function, it's going to be downward sloping as a function of the real interest rate. We've already also spoken about the supply of money, and we said that the money supply is essentially under the direct control of the central bank, even though the commercial banks can also influence the level of money supply. Now, since the central banks directly control the money supply, we are going to assume that the supply of money is independent of the level of interest rate. That is, it's a vertical function. It's when we draw the supply of money with the money supply on the horizontal axis and the interest rate on the vertical axis, is going to be a vertical. It's going to be vertical. So, like we've just explained, this is a downward sloping demand for money function, and then this is the supply of money. So this demand for money function, we said, is the real demand for money. And the supply of money is written M over P. The M stands for the nominal money supply, and the P is the price level. So M over P is the real supply of money. And that has to be the case, because if the demand for money is the real demand for money, the supply of money has to be the real supply of money. So on the vertical axis here, we have the real interest rate, and on the horizontal axis, we have the real money balances. Now, the demand for money curve is downward sloping because, as we have explained, the higher the real interest rate, the lower the quantity of money we want to hold. The equilibrium in the money market occurs when the demand for money curve intersects the supply of money curve. And this occurs here. So R star R here is the equilibrium real interest rate, and then M star is the equilibrium money balances. So now that we've understood the money market and how it works, our next task is to try and understand how monetary policy works. So how do monetary policy work? If the central bank want to reduce the money supply, how does it work? So in this case, consider a change in money supply. First, in the money market, when there's a change in money supply, it's going to shift the money supply curve. So remember, if we get back to the money market again, this is the M here is the nominal money supply. That is what is controlled by the central bank, and P is the price level. So if the central bank decides to reduce the nominal money supply, it means that the M is going to fall, and given the price level, is going to reduce the real money supply. That is, this curve will shift. And when this curve shifts, that's going to affect the equilibrium. So it's going to determine a new equilibrium, and then that will determine a new interest rate. So in essence, that's the transmission mechanism for monetary policy. The change in money supply in the money market is going to shift the money supply curve, and that's going to determine a new interest rate. And that new interest rate is going to affect the level of investment and or consumption expenditures. Okay, now to understand the transmission mechanism clearly, we now make reference to the Monetary Policy Committee statement of the Bank of Ghana for November 2015. So if you go back to the link provided in the under the reading list and you click on that link, so if you go back to this link and you click on it, you'll be able to download the, you see all the Monetary Policy Committee press releases. Now download the one for November 2015, and then we are going to use that as an example. So in this particular press release, you realize that the central bank was concerned about the level of inflation. In points 4 and 6, and also in the summary, it makes it clear. So take your time and read point 6 and point 4, and then also point 11 of the statement. And you notice that the central bank was concerned about inflation and then inflation expectations. So in order to deal with its concern about inflation and its expectation, what the central bank did was to increase the monetary policy rate from 25% to 26%. And you can see this in point 2. So the main monetary policy measure here is that the monetary policy rate was increased from 25% to 26%. Now, let's try and explain here. Even though we said that monetary policy refers to the central bank trying to change the money supply, around the world, monetary policy is communicated in terms of the interest rate. So even when the central bank is trying to increase the money supply, it will not say that we are trying to increase the money supply by this percentage. It will simply say that we are trying to, they will simply communicate that by reducing a policy rate. In Ghana, the policy interest rate controlled by the central bank is called the monetary policy rate. In other countries, they call it different names. In the US, it is called the federal funds rate. In some countries, it's called the bank rate. But in Ghana, it's called the monetary policy rate. So the way we have to interpret this increase in monetary policy rate is that the central bank is trying to reduce the money supply. Therefore, we will call this a contractionary fiscal monetary policy. Therefore, we call this a contractionary monetary policy or monetary tightening. And the goal, as we have already read, is that the bank is the MPC is concerned about the rate of inflation in the country. So the increase in the policy rate was meant to help fight the inflation. Now our task to try and understand, how does this increase in the policy rate help the central bank to fight inflation? First, we see that the increase in the monetary policy rate represents a decrease in the money supply. So in the money market, the decrease in money supply is going to reduce the real money supply and it's going to shift the money supply curve to the left. Now, when the money supply curve shifts to the left, you realize that the equilibrium interest rate is going to rise. Now, when the interest rate rises, what will happen? You already learned that when interest rates are high, the level of investment demand will fall. So investment demand will fall. At the same time, when interest rates are high, the consumption expenditures will also fall. So both desired consumption and desired investment will fall. Therefore, this is going to reduce aggregate demand. And that's what is going to help bring demand down and help reduce the rate of inflation. So just to quickly recap again. So later on, we are going to learn about the aggregate demand, aggregate supply framework. But when there's a decrease in the money supply, this is going to shift the real money supply curve to the left, and it's going to lead to an increase in the real interest rate. The increase in the real interest rate is going to reduce the level of investment demand and consumption demand, and therefore reduce overall demand for goods and services. And that is how the price level comes down, and that is a reduction in the level of inflation. So that's it for today's session. The key reference for this session can be found in the book by Cooper and John, and also the MPC press releases that we just referred to. So we're going to wrap it up here for now, and then I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for watching.